today our paper is Historical Development of Civil Society in Korea since democratization in 1987. And we'll focus a set of current issues and also ponder some future prospects. And I worked on this paper together with Professor Chung Ho Chung, who's there. And this is a series of work actually we are currently conducting. First, we will focus on the Korean case, but we have this plan to expand the empirical analysis into some other East Asian countries, including China, and we'll eventually conduct a full-fledged comparative analysis of different forms of civil society and different ways in which civil society has developed in different East Asian societies, East Asian countries, and so forth. So in that respect, this is a paper still in progress. And I will mostly focus on three different issues here. The first one is a conceptual discussion, what civil society is, and focusing on several different dimensions, because we need a definitional discussion before we talk about the South Korean civil society in greater detail. And then I will summarize what happened in civil society in South Korea since 1987, particularly several prominent characteristics of civil society in the recent years. And then I will try to derive some issues that are related with future prospects of South Korean civil society, because South Korean civil society, in our opinion, is undergoing some important transformation. And that transformation is not only important for the case of South Korea, but also has broader theoretical implications for other cases in Asia and beyond. So I will structure my talk in terms of those three different aspects. First, I'd like to have a brief discussion on the definition of civil society. And civil society, according to the literature, of course, there is this fundamental debate on whether the concept of civil society is a concept that can travel well to East Asian societies, because it's largely a concept that was based on the Western European cases. But in our opinion, I think we see some fruitful applicability of civil society in the East Asian cases. And civil society is defined in three different dimensions. First, civil society does involve this important organizational dimension of society, something that is organized within society. And also, secondly, civil society in the Western literature and in East Asian literature also has a lot of relationships with other societal arenas, including most importantly the state, but also what is called political society, political parties and electoral campaigns. And lastly, it also has this relationship with so-called economic society market. And lastly, it also has relationship with parochial society, families. And so in contrast with these other societies, civil society is distinct from these other societal spheres. But at the same time, civil society maintains and forges important relationships with these other societal spheres. The last dimension is the normative dimension, because civil society, after all, is civil society, not just a part of society, not just a subset of general society, but civil society, which does include this value or norm of civility. So combining these different dimensions, one of the dominant definitions of civil society in the literature is a set of self-organized groups and movements in society that are relatively autonomous from the state, basic units of production and reproduction, and political society. So this independence of other societies is essential element of civil society, and are capable of political activities in the public sphere to express their concerns and advance their interests according to the principles of pluralism and self-governance. So I'd like to note that this is the operative definition we are using throughout our paper. And so we are using this concept of civil society in analyzing the case of South Korea. As defined as such, examples of civil society include trade unions, most representatively, and business associations, and movement organizations like environmental groups, student groups, and women's movement organizations, and so forth. Now let's go to the South Korean case specifically. In South Korea, the importance of civil society cannot be overemphasized, because there is this broad and almost indisputable consensus in the literature on democratic transition and consolidation that South Korea, as compared with some cases in, for example, in Southern Europe in the 1970s or in Latin America in the 1980s, South Korea is a case that showcases this case of democratization through movement. So there were a lot of social movements, there were a lot of cases of mass mobilization. And so it is a transition to democracy, a case of transition to democracy that was featured by this mass ascendance and mass mobilization and social movements against the authoritarian government. So before we talk about what happened to civil society after this democratic transition, critical democratic transition in 1987, I'd like to briefly talk about what civil society looked like under authoritarian governments in the 70s, in the 80s. During those authoritarian governments, civil society was largely dichotomized. It was a black and white kind of picture. Although after democratization, it became a little bit variegated. But during the authoritarian governments, on the one hand, there was this authoritarian state, plus pro-government state cooperative social groups. So these social groups include, for example, pro-state Federation of Korea Trade Unions, and there was also this Employers Federation, and there was this Federation of Big Business Conglomerates, which is called Chaebol in Korea. And so they were the main elements of this state corporatist apparatus. But there is this very important conceptual question whether these elements are like FKTU or KEF or FKI, the Korean industries, where they can be called civil society because they fundamentally lacked this autonomy from the state. For example, they were sponsored, financially sponsored by the government, and their personnel were pinpointed by the picked by the government also, and they were organizationally not very independent of the government control. So in that respect, we have some doubts whether they are truly in the spirit of a civil society. But nevertheless, there was this on the one hand, and on the other hand, there were these a number of illegal underground organizations and dissident groups that are in this overall pro-democracy, anti-authoritarian camp during the 70s and 80s. One example in the 1980s is this National Coalition for Democracy movement. So it was an assemblage of these movement associations that fought against the authoritarian government and fought for democratization. On the other hand, this is a very small portion of civil society sphere in general, but there was a small number of non-political and relatively quote and unquote neutral social groups like YMCA. This kind of black and white or polarized picture changed dramatically after democratization. On the one hand, there was this process of what I call decorporatization of formerly state corporatist groups. So those groups who were tightly controlled by the authoritarian governments in the 70s and 80s were slowly released from the state control, and they gained autonomy from the state, and they were now featured by organizational pluralization, and they tried to recover the legitimacy they did not enjoy during the 70s and 80s. On the other hand, there was also this important change of legalization of formerly illegal underground organizations. So they came to the fore, they came to the sunlight, so to speak, and these dissident groups gained legal status and recognition. And these groups were the groups which led the pro-democracy movement against the authoritarian government. They were called people's movement groups, and people's movement groups are now contrasted with these new civil society groups that belongs to this third category here. New civil society groups emerged in the aftermath of the democratization in 1987. And one of the most typical, most representative new civil society groups is called Citizens Coalition for Economic Justice. And later, People's Solidarity for Participatory Democracy and Korean Federation of Environmental Movement. So these citizens movement groups developed together, or in addition to the existing people's movement groups. So now at least I think there is this tricolor kind of configuration in civil society. There was this decorporatized groups, and there were legalized, formerly underground civil society groups and new groups here. Let me show you some pictures here. South Korean civil society is featured with this kind of massive mobilization of people. Millions of people poured to the streets of South Korean capital. And this is June, I think, 10th of June in 1987, so democratization movement where millions of people gathered together to protest authoritarian government. And this is the one of the civil society groups' inaugural ceremony of one of the civil society groups I just mentioned. And so this economic justice was not really highlighted during the 70s and 80s, but now these new issues were also actively explored in the aftermath of the democratization. Korean Federation of Environment Movement. Environmental movement is also another very important topical area into which South Korean civil societies explored. And People's Solidarity for Participatory Democracy focused on political rights and making the political arena more participatory and this in active political intervention into the representative domain. Let me go back to the presentation. So those are some of the important changes that happened after the democratization. And let me briefly summarize some of the pivotal characteristics of post-transitional civil society in South Korea. One is that as compared with the past in the 70s and 80s under the authoritarian government, where the state-society relationship was largely confrontational and hostile, now the state-society relationship has been diversified. So as compared with the past where conflict, resistance, struggle against the state was the main feature of a state-society relationship, now it is very variegated, diversified. Sometimes civil society groups compete with the state in terms of delivering better services and goods, for example, or in trying to get support from the public. And they cooperate with each other, of course, and they collaborate with each other. On the other hand, intra-civil society features also have become pretty complicated, and civil societies cooperate with one another, and they mutually rely on one another, or they compete with each other, or sometimes important conflicts emerge within civil society, as I will explain later in more detail. And another important characteristic of post-transitional South Korean civil society is this very excessive politicization of civil society groups in Korea, ideological fragmentation. In the 70s and 80s, there was this grand pro-democracy alliance, so united under one flag against the authoritarian government and under this overall torch of democracy movement. But now, particularly since 2000, I mean, there was during the Kim Dae-jung government, and Kim Dae-jung government was aggressively pursued this policy of engagement toward North Korea, which was called the Sunshine Policy. And on this Sunshine Policy, there was this big fragmentation and controversy and debate within South Korea about the efficacy of the policy and so on. And that became the origin of this big kind of divergence and conflict between so-called left camp and right camp and progressive camp and conservative camp over the Sunshine Policy, but not only over the Sunshine Policy, but on a lot of other policies also later. On the other hand, another momentum for politicization of civil society was the success and subsequent failure of the so-called blacklisting movement, which I'd like to show the picture here. So this is the blacklisting movement in 2000, and this is the blacklisting movement in 2004. And the main idea of blacklisting movement is that civil society groups toward 2000 or 1999, they concluded that, they called for political reform of South Korea many, many times for a very long time. But they thought that this campaign for political reforms would have not been that effective. And the only way they could change the nature and the characteristic, the quality, improve the quality of politics is to directly intervene into the electoral process. So what they came up with as an idea is that they came up with a list of those people who should not be elected because they have some problems. They have some criminal records, for example. They are not very sincere in terms of their legislative activities, or they were involved in some former unconstitutional problems and so on. So they blacklisted those people. And a lot of those people in 2000 particularly, a lot of those people who were blacklisted in that list by civil society groups failed to be elected. So the movement in 2000 was a real success. But as compared with the movement in 2000, 4 years later, when there was another general election, there was another round of movement, blacklisting movement. But in 2004, the movement was not as successful as it was the case in 2000, because people thought that somehow the list is a little bit politicized, and the list only represented the candidates from one particular political party, and it is not really balanced between political parties and so on. So This second round of blacklisting movement actually did not work very well, and it also provided some momentum for extraordinary politicization of civil society. And civil society is fragmented in South Korea since 2000 because in terms of their support for different governments. So you can see these progressive groups in civil society and conservative groups in civil society. So progressive civil society groups like PSPD here, People's Solidarity for Participatory Democracy, was particularly influential in policymaking process during the Kim Dae-jung government and Noh Moo-hyun government, so-called progressive governments. On the other hand, the New Right, the group, was influential during the Lee Myung-bak government. So depending on what was the ideological basis of an incumbent government, different groups in civil society became influential, which is another piece of evidence of politicization of civil society. And the downside or the cost of this politicization is that earlier periods in the 1980s, in the late 1980s, South Korean people trusted civil society groups much, much strongly as compared with political parties. But now civil society groups, they know that civil society groups are as political as political parties. So this public trust has been eroded in the recent years. The third characteristic is that a lot of civil society groups individually, civil society groups participated in real politics, and individuals from civil society also participated in real politics. So in that sense, boundary between political society and civil society has been blurred, and civil society became more like political society. There are a lot of individual leaders of civil society who participated in civil society, in political society, and became politicians themselves. There is Mr. Park Se-il, who was a leader of Citizens Coalition for Economic Justice, a key member of civil society groups, but he later became a kind of advisor in the Blue House. Blue House is a presidential office in Korea, and he later became a legislator of the Conservative Party. And on another case is Mr. Lee Seok-yeon. and who was a key member of the new right, and he became a minister of administrative legislation during the first 2 years of the Lee Myung-bak government. Lee Myung-bak government is a conservative government between 2008 and 2013. And also, so he was involved in this CCJ, the same civil society group, but he became a minister joining the conservative government. Another example on the progressive side is this Kim Gi-shi, who's a National Assembly man, a National Assembly legislator currently. And he was one of the founders, co-founders of this very important People's Solidarity for Participatory Democracy, together with Mr. Park Won-sun. I mean, they together created this civil society group. But he joined the political circles as a legislator in 2012. And as some of you know, Park Won-sun is the mayor of Seoul Metropolitan City and one of the very promising candidates for the presidential election in 2017. So there were some these prominent cases of participation of civil society leaders in political parties or the government. And that's another characteristic of post-transitional civil society. Not only individuals, but also groups participating in the policy-making process of different political governments. For example, Citizens Coalition for Citizens Coalition for Economic Justice was prominent in terms of policy-making influence during the Kim Il-sung government, and People's Solidarity for Participatory Democracy during the Kim Dae-jung government and Nong-Myon government, and New Right Movement in general was influential during the Lee Myung-bak government. Now, this individual participation or group participation in the political society is positive in some sense, but at the same time, it has some negative aspect in the sense that it eventually hollows the civil society arena, and it depopulates the civil society arena. And as I already mentioned, it sometimes is leading to this undermining of the trust of civil society. People thought that civil society leaders were neutral, were kind of non-partisan, or they are really publicly minded, but they are now just as partisan as other, as party politicians, unlike the expectation. And another important characteristic of South Korean civil society is it is geographically focused on the capital, on the Seoul area, and focus on politics at the center. So there is this big gap between central civil society and local civil society, and most of the civil society groups are deeply involved in central politics, and this is a big contrast between Korean civil society and Japanese civil society. Because Japanese civil society are very locally oriented in terms of actual practical solving of local problems, but they don't enjoy any central political influence. On the other hand, South Korean civil society groups enjoy a substantial amount of influence on the central government policy making, but we are constantly confronted with this problem of that civil society groups in South Korea do not really provide actual solution to actual policy problems. They lack this practicality of the proposals. So there exists this great gap between the civil society center and the civil society in local areas, which is also another important future task. Lastly, one characteristic of post-transition civil society in South Korea is that these days, civil society groups are very much dependent on the state. In the past, in the 70s and 80s, because I mean, largely the relationship was conflictual, there was no relationship of dependence. In 2000, under the Kim Dae-jung government, legislation happened, which was called NPO Assistance Act. The policy intention was rather good because the intention was to help these financially weak civil society groups with state support. But the problem is that depending on which government of a different ideological colors, which government was incumbent, sometimes, for example, a conservative government only preferred to support only conservative civil society groups, while progressive government preferred to support progressive groups. So there was this obvious correlation between the nature of the ideological basis behind the government and the type of civil society groups which were supported. So this led to this increased dependency of civil society groups on the state in terms of their financial management, and raises fundamental questions about the nature and definition of civil society, whether organizational autonomy or political impartiality or ideological neutrality, which are very important underlying characteristics of civil society, whether those important values are undermined, these well-intentioned but rather unintended consequences of the state assistance, financial assistance to civil society groups. Now let me just briefly talk about the prospects and challenges. South Korean civil society has come a long way from its combative nature during the authoritarian period, and after that, South Korean civil society continued to play an important role in galvanizing political reforms and in pushing for some improvement of the quality of South Korean politics and so forth. But there is this important task of functional diversification. So far, South Korean civil society has been too much focused on political campaign, so civic mobilization and policy advocacy. So largely the movement remained abstract and did not come up with practical solutions to specific policy programs. So what we think as future prospects in South Korean civil society should be more diversified. You know, there should be, of course, I mean, there should be some movement organizations, but the proportion should be variegated. I mean, we should have policy advocacy groups, but at the same time, we should have civil society groups that work on specific service provision. So some civil society groups should work on welfare facility provision, for example, or there should be more social enterprises that need to provide those basic necessities that people greatly want these days, and so on. On the other hand, to overcome this lack of specificity of some proposals civil society groups are advocating, we need some more private think tanks. We need more civil society think tanks that work on specific policy proposals and practicable solutions on important matters of South Korean society. So I think one of the important future challenges is how we can come up with these other types of civil society groups in addition to this long tradition of political advocacy organizations in South Korea. So in conclusion, I think there should be more research done on leadership and management related with civil society organizations in South Korea, and what are the constructive future prospects of South Korean civil society, and what are the broader implications of the South Korean case for other East Asian countries and beyond East Asia. So that would be the end of my presentation. Thank you very much.